As of 2 p.m. today, there have been 7,562 positive cases of COVID-19, including 329 deaths. Over 81,000 Missourians have been tested at this time. In the last week or so, there's been lots of questions of about the utilities, about rent, about eviction, and today I'm going to try to cover over some of the things that's in the CARES Act, some of the things we're doing in the states to clarify some of that. I know there's been several questions of that. So let me just kind of start with the CARES Act to kind of say kind of what we're doing on that, what Missouri's portion of that is. But under the federal CARES Act, Missouri will be receiving funding to help support additional housing resources and assistance, such as community development block grants. Existing emergency regulations allow for grant payments to providers for items and services such as food, clothing, housing, or utilities on the behalf of an individual or family. With this funding, 15 of Missouri's largest cities and counties, including the St. Louis and Kansas City metro regions, will receive over $24 million in additional assistance. Another area of the CARES Act funding will support is the Emergency Solution Grant. Missouri will receive approximately $9.4 million. These funds can specifically be used to help unsheltered homeless, sheltered homeless, and those at risk of homelessness. The funds can also be used for eviction prevention assistance, including rapid rehousing, housing counseling, and rental deposit assistance. And we anticipate federal guidance on these funds in the next few weeks. In addition to these grants, several ways Missourians can receive housing-related assistance. Under the CARES Act, a moratorium on foreclosures for all federal-backed mortgages, including those covered by HUD, the U.S. Department of Agriculture, the Federal Housing Administration, the Department of Veterans Affairs, Fannie Mae, and Freddie Mac, was put in place for 60 days starting March the 18th. On top of this, a borrower experiencing a financial hardship due to COVID-19 may request an extension for up to 180 days. Additionally, $900 million under the CARES Act was set aside for supplemental funding to help low-income families through the Low-Income Home Energy Assistance Program. This program specifically assists families in paying their utility bills. Now, at the state level, our administration worked with the investor-owned utility companies throughout Missouri to stop disconnects and shutoffs related to COVID-19, ensuring that Missourians would not have disruptions in utility services in the face of an economic hardship. Further, under the direction of my administration, the Missouri Housing Development Corporation is working on guidance that will provide additional $9 million in rent assistance to individuals and families that have experienced an economic setback from COVID-19. And finally, on April the 1st, the Missouri Supreme Court and several judicial circuits announced that they would suspend or postpone proceedings that included eviction or foreclosure cases until May the 15th. Also, in addition to concerns and questions that have been coming up, we've also continued to get questions regarding schools, both K-12 and higher education. And today, Commissioner Van Deven and Commissioner Mulligan are here to give us an update. So first, I would like to ask Commissioner Van Deven for an update on DESE. Margie?
Thank you, Governor Parson. Good afternoon. As we think purposefully about reopening the state of Missouri, we at the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education are learning how our team members transition to providing services while working remotely and also looking ahead at what's to come in the next several months. You may be accustomed to hearing our department talk about K-12 education, and many are not aware that the agency also houses vocational rehabilitation and disability determination offices that provide critical services to so many Missourians. Over the last 8 weeks, our vocational rehabilitation team members have served well over 14,000 individuals with disabilities each day on average while working remotely. That's nearly 100% of their normal workload, and our disability determinations colleagues working remotely have processed over 13,000 cases in these last 8 weeks, and that's about 90% of the cases typically processed. The leaders and staff members in these programs have remained committed to providing uninterrupted services to their clients throughout this time of uncertainty. And now back to K-12 education. As I've shared each time that I've been at the podium over the last several weeks, I continue to be impressed by our school leaders, educators, and staff members for continuing to serve Missouri students, even though school buildings remain closed through the academic school year. We will see schools begin to wrap up a remote learning in the coming weeks as school calendar end dates vary from district to district. Until then, schools are continuing to provide services to students, including remote learning and much-needed meals. We're proud to say that more than 1.3 million meals have been served by our schools across our great state during these extended school closures. Now, both Governor Parson and the State Board of Education recognize and reiterate the importance of celebrating our class of 2020. We have urged school leaders to think about creative ways to honor Missouri's graduating seniors and to celebrate their accomplishments, but in a way that protects public health and abides by social distancing protocols. This will look different for each district as graduating class size across Missouri's range from 2 students to nearly 2,000 students. We hope our seniors know how truly proud we are of them as they each take the next step into their future. Also, many people are wondering about what summer school will look like. Districts and charters are working to find the best solution they can for their students, families, and staff members. To help with that, our department issued guidance on summer school to our leaders last week. This guidance was informed by task force recommendations that emphasized scheduling flexibility to help accommodate these unique times, as well as establishing expectations for both remote and face-to-face summer learning opportunities. While summer school remains optional for most of our students, this may be a time that more families consider this opportunity for learning, given the extended building closures. Last but certainly not least, DESE is preparing to distribute millions of dollars from the CARES Act to our local schools in the coming weeks. Missouri schools will receive $117 million from the USDA to reimburse schools for meals served during these extended closures. Today, DESE team members are submitting the final necessary information to the U.S. Department of Education to receive the $208 million that Missouri is getting for the Elementary and Secondary Education School Emergency Relief Fund. Our agency is doing all that we can to prepare for the incoming funds so that we can get those much-needed dollars out to schools as quickly as possible. These funds will allow school leaders to address remote teaching and learning challenges and other important educational needs resulting from COVID-19. And finally, we look forward to working with the Governor's Office and the Department of Higher Education and Workforce Development in implementing the Governor's Emergency Education Relief Fund. Once again, thank you to the many school leaders, educators, and school support staff members, as well as our parents, grandparents, and guardians at home, who have worked tirelessly to ensure that our children continue to take part in educational opportunities during this time of uncertainty, and for continuing to do so in the coming weeks. Thank you.
Thank you, Margie. And Let me just say this for Desi and for the teachers out there, the administrators, to go what we've gone through and to be prepared and do what they've done in some of the most unusual circumstances is pretty amazing. It's just another one of those reasons why Missouri's work ethic showcases every time we get into situations like that. So I want to thank the education, everybody involved in the education, to keep going what they've been able to educate those kids and being prepared. And also on a personal note, as a grandparent, I've got a granddaughter that's graduating in 2020, so I'm kind of rooting for those graduation dates to make sure they get an opportunity to get those diplomas in there. And I think sometimes she thinks I can do miracles, but again, I'll be working with Desi and the administration to see what we can do for those high school seniors on that. The other one that's here today, Commissioner Mulligan's here today, that will give us an update on higher education and workforce developments, which will be crucial to the opening phases of our state and the future in the months to come. So, Commissioner Mulligan.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. I want to talk about five major priorities that the Department of Higher Education and Workforce Development has focused on and will continue to focus on as we continue to move through this unusual set of circumstances. Our first and most immediate priority has been about immediate needs, so immediate workforce needs, immediate supply needs. Our colleges and universities have played a vital role in helping the state secure the PPE it needs to keep healthcare and other workers safe. Our colleges and universities have also been engaged in conversations about other ways to help in the crisis, sheltering the sick, providing housing for healthcare workers who can't go home. So the immediate response has been very, very full-hearted and has reflected a great deal of passion for service on the part of our colleges and universities. At the state level, we also have been really focused on making sure we have the workforce we need to respond to the unique needs that the current situation presents. And that would include examples like working with the University of Missouri and its extension and healthcare services to provide training to temporary healthcare workers who have worked in the alternate care sites around the state. We will also be helping recruit the workers needed for contact tracing as that becomes a more real part of every day of our lives. And so we're really grateful for the opportunity to meet these immediate needs. Other immediate needs that our colleges and universities have met has been supported by the CARES Act that the governor spoke about a little bit and Commissioner Van Deven provided more information about. Our colleges and universities, both 2- and 4-year, public and private, have received funds that they've been able to use to help students directly. Half of the money that those institutions used had to be used for student help directly, and also to respond to other kinds of needs on campus as a result of COVID-19. And so that would include everything from setting up laptop libraries that students can use when they don't have access at home, to buying hotspots, to doing professional development around online education. So our colleges and universities have been very hard at work to make sure that their students' spring semesters can continue in a new format, but with instruction uninterrupted. We're also focusing on the future of the Department of Higher Education, so transitioning from the immediate crisis to thinking about what comes next. We know that economic recovery is going to be a topic at the front of everyone's minds, and we're looking forward to contributing to that conversation. Our priorities in this area are making sure that Missourians have an opportunity to skill up and get the help they need to get back to work, that students will get the support they need, not just in this spring semester, but over the summer, the fall, and beyond. And we also want to make sure that the public workforce system emerges from this crisis stronger, more resilient, and more accessible than it was at the beginning. And the same true for the higher education system. This is an opportunity to really rethink the way we do our business, and we're excited about this conversation. Last but not least, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that the last of our goals really focuses on making sure that as a department, we emerge from this stronger, more cohesive, and better prepared for the next major disruption. I think like a lot of communities around the state, we have learned a lot about each other as we have shifted to remote work, but the thing that's been most clear, most consistently, is the passion with which the people who work for our department serve the citizens of the state of Missouri. They've been absolutely unrelenting, and I am grateful for the service they have provided. So please stay tuned. We're going to have a lot more to talk about in this space as the months progress, and thank you for being here today.
Zora, thank you very much. And also, as we go through this recovery process, that's going to be one of the, let me just say, I think they're all busy right now, my directors and commissioners, but we're going to be relying on that to get people back in the workforce, to get them back in those training programs are going to be critical to moving our economy forward. So, Zora, thank you, and thank you for what you, all your team's doing over there.